Welcome back to Ranger, Massachusetts for another four-week ladder series of classic Candlepins. For our entire crew here at the beautiful, spacious Classic Candlepins Control Center, I'm Kyle Bruce, along with the legendary Frank Face. And Frank, we have John Starner, who will be coming back, our first person to come back on our show, to be facing Mike Legendre from Blackstone. One of the things I wanted to ask you is, what do you think is going through Starner's mind as he's, you know, he already won a match in the first ladder. Maybe he didn't bowl as well as he may have wanted to. But he has another opportunity with it being his fifth seed of this ladder.
Well, I think the contributing factor to that is John has quite a bit of experience at this house in Amesbury, both on Friday nights and within the previous ladder series of Classic Candlepins. That's going to have to add to his confidence. I think it's going to possibly work into his favor, and we'll see what happens.
Great. This match will face Dave Chester Cove next week in the second round. We'll be back with the Classic Candlepins post-game show. Hope you enjoy the match.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back to downtown Amesbury, Massachusetts for week one of our next four-week ladder series on Classic Candlepins. For our entire crew and my partner, Rich Lamoni, I'm Kyle Bruce. And Rich, this is a match which features John Starner, who is here for our first ladder, won a match. He's back. And this time he's going to be facing Mike Legendre. And this is going to be an interesting ladder because seven pins separate the first four bowlers of the ladder.
Yeah, I mean, you needed every pin in order to make the cut. And these guys, you know, these five guys that are in it, bowled great. They deserve to be here. We see a return from John Starner, which is nice. It's our first repeat bowler on the show, so I mean, see if he improves on his run last time. Maybe he'll run the ladder.
What can we expect from Mike?
You know, I don't know that much about Mike. I've seen him here and there, and you know, I bowled against him on Friday. He bowled great in the New England knockout, and I think he raised a lot of eyebrows with how well he's done. So I'm assuming it's going to translate here. He's going to be a tough opponent.
Well, this, like I said, this will be the what we hope to be our best ladder of the show so far. John Starner will throw our first ball right after this timeout. Welcome back to downtown Amesbury, Massachusetts for week one of our four-week ladder series. John Starner's up on lane 7. He was in a zen-like state before we came back from commercial. So let's see if that helps him in this match. Unable to break up the split here, 6-7-10. John was on our first match of our first ladder series and had a victory.
He bowled great, and he made the, what was it, 5-6-10, what, three times?
It was either 4-5-7 or 5-6-10. He made, I know he made it at least twice with no wood, and anyone who knows the sport knows how difficult that is. 10 box to start off our match here. And then John fell in the second round to Keith Beaupre. 310 to 291. He carries a 123 average.
It's on the head pin again.
And the four pin is reluctant. It won't go. And this is another split here. 4-6-10. Wood perpendicular to the pit against that four pin. Good bid, but I don't think the wood had the angle.
Yeah, and he doesn't throw it nearly as hard as some of the other bowlers out there. Maybe if he, you know, throws it as hard as, you know, someone like Baker, that might have, that Sean Baker, that may have gone, you know, may have slid over there, at least made an attempt.
Score that a 9. 19 after 2.
Not much you can ask for hitting the head pin.
And here's our first look at Mike Legendre. Mike is from Blackstone. Been on, no stranger to television.
He faced his twin brother on the Comcast show.
I remember that, yes. Nice bid, but couldn't carry the 10. And of course, along with us today is the infamous, or is it famous, Frank Face.
You could say either or, I suppose.
Yes. Mike starts off his match with a 10. Mike, the owner of a 114 average, 184 high single, and a 452 high triple. Looking at the triangle right now, 3-5-6.
Pretty standard leave.
But not easy to convert.
Absolutely not. I feel like I find the triangle harder than the diamond.
Well,
for some odd reason.
Maybe, I don't know, it's the sleeper in the back on the diamond that I think makes it hard to convert sometimes. It's almost like you need to be a little heavy on it. And Mike is also at 19.
Well, the funny thing is, if you throw that same ball at the head pin, you get an eagle. So,
right.
You know. Takes out the eagle pretty, you know, effectively. You'd figure you'd take the diamond with that same ball.
Hard to find someone that throws a smoother ball than John Starner. You can barely hear it hit the lane.
That you have to be smooth.
Yes.
If you're all over the place, it's going to be hard for you to score.
And
you shouldn't have said that about him as he just bounced that last ball.
I know.
It was a jinx.
It was a curse. Still six pins standing. Didn't get the action he wanted that time. He has a six, which makes him 25 after three. In case you didn't recall from last time, John was on the Comcast show at age 16. Right in the pocket, and the five pin
goes.
There it goes.
First mark of the day.
Yes.
Mike steps up on lane seven.
Mike looking at the high-low jack right here.
Got some pretty good movement out of that, considering you missed the head pin.
This is a very short approach.
Well, leaves a little room for error.
Nice shot.
There you go. Good job. That's how to hit the high-low jack. Probably would have gone without the wood.
This is true. Here's the bonus.
All
and
over the pocket.
Yes.
There he goes.
A strike on spare for Mike Legendre. He drove a long way to be here, and he's going to make his appearance count no matter what. Matching strikes in the fourth. First bonus ball, John nets six. He's got four horsemen right, no wood to help.
I still say play it outside.
Ball faded a bit. He'll fill his strike with seven. John, the owner of a 123 league average. His high single is 190 and a high triple of 470, as he has a nine box here in the fifth, which gives him a 51 half. The winner of this match will face our number three seed, Dave Chester Cove. And as I had mentioned in the open, we have seven pins separating seed one through four. As we have a split on lane six for John, 6, 7, 10.
Head pin clearly has not been his best friend so far. It's his third split so far. Things will start falling his way if he keeps hitting it, though.
Well, that's the name of the game. If you're on the head pin, sometimes, you know, you're half a board away from being right in the pocket where you need to be and break up that split. Mike Legendre back up, working on a strike in the fourth. Carries five with the first ball.
1, 3, 5, 8, 9. He's got a piece of wood against the 8 and 9. Might help carry.
Yes!
Nice shot. Three in a row.
Mike, the early 17-pin advantage here in our first string of the first round. Today, manning the scoreboard is also the aforementioned Frank Face.
Yes, new electronic scoreboard.
Yes, and we can thank Scott Moore for developing that as Mike is right through the middle, 159. But that puts him at a 72 half, so throwing 637 here is no joke, number one. Having a 72 half is a good start anywhere. Eight bucks. Puts him at 80 and the lead is 20.
Frank, when you streamed the finals of the New England Knockout, you and Nick had a conversation. Nick Zuffalato, affectionately known as Freshy. You guys had a conversation about the 3 and 4.
We did.
How you would shoot it. You both said you'd go for the 3 instead of the 4, right?
And yeah, I believe that's the best way to play it because you want to cut that front pin to the back row somehow and some get some mixing action, and that would give you the best chance of doing that.
I would tend to agree. That's the way I would shoot it, too.
If you have it, use it.
I have a question, though.
Yes.
As it concerns that leave, as John has a 9 box here in the 7th. If you're filling a strike, would you go for the cluster 4 to get the bigger fill?
The cluster of 4 doesn't seem to always go.
It's hard with that one in the back.
Indeed,
too.
It is. Yeah.
Either the 8 or the 9.
So I think I'd still take the same approach.
Yeah.
Good question.
Hey, that's why they give me the big bucks.
Yes.
This is one of the few times that John's off the head pin.
That is an ugly assortment of pins up there.
Well, like
one,
you
three,
said,
4, 6, 7, and 9.
Yes. Like you said, Rich. I mean, he's been on so far. He's had the splits, but he keeps throwing the same ball. Good things are bound to happen. That's John's second 6 ball to the first string, and that puts him at 75. Mike is back up, box 7, first string, leading by 20, and box is completed. Brooklyn pocket.
That looked like it should have been a better leave than that. He's looking at 5, 7, 8, 9.
I don't think that wood's going to do much to help either.
If you could get super low on it, the problem there is you won't have enough force to drive it across to take out all 4 pins, I don't think.
That was a nice bid.
Yeah, absolutely. That's the way I would have played it.
He looks like he's on.
He's bowling very well.
That'll That'll be an 8 box in the 7th. Which puts Mike at 88. So John picks up a pin and count here.
I think that was one of the situations of the New England knockout, is that not many people see Mike. And they see the 114 average. That's out of Fico's, which is a tough house.
Yes, it is.
And, you know, that's where he does his all his bowling. And it makes him a better bowler. So then when he walks into a place like, you know, when he faced Irby in the New England knockout, he throws a 180 and he wins. You know, and I think it took a lot of people by surprise.
Ooh. I don't think that wood had the angle to carry the 10.
With that 180, he covered an enormous deficit.
True. And to be
some.
Yes. And to be fair, that's a 10 box for Mike. To be fair, Irby is a guy who also bowled very well that day,
yes.
Number one, and is also a subscriber of bowling to the legit house, because if you can master bowling somewhere where you have to earn every pin, you can go anywhere.
Sure you can.
So. That's a triangle right, 3, 5, and 6. Slid by the 3 that time. John still searching for his second mark of the first string. The 9 box will put him at 84, so he needs a mark 6 for 100. One thing we want to encourage our viewers to do is to, if you're not in Amesbury and you generally watch the matches on YouTube, please follow the channel so you'll be up to date with all our current programming here on Classic Candlepins. You can go on the Classic Candlepins Facebook page for any roll-off information. And if you have any questions, concerns, sarcastic remarks, you can call 978-792-5475 and talk to anybody who's here. You can even talk to my Uncle Steve for...
That's always fun.
It is, yes.
He loves the sarcasm, too.
Yes. John starts the first string of our first match with a 92. He was open the last 6 boxes.
And that's another one of those situations where he bowled well. And, you know, people look at a piece of paper or, you know, see it on a computer screen and say 92, he must have, you know, he couldn't have done well. John was all over the head pin, and he just had nothing to show for it.
Mike got some good action off the head pin that time. He's looking at 1, 2, and 10, and that piece of lumber in front of the 10 is only going to help him.
Right
like
there.
That. His 4th mark of the first string. Puts him at 108 with a ball. Bonus. Right in the pocket, and he's got a 2-pinner. 5-8. Should have a clear shot at it, Rich.
Yeah, that wood shouldn't come into play. I would try to avoid it, that's for sure.
Put it down.
All over it. That's what you want to do. Especially when the guy is open and 9 and 10. You can put 2 in there. It's a great job. That's 5th mark of the string.
There's a profile of our number 4 seed. And he fills it with a 5. That puts him at 131. So, at the end of our first string, our first round matchup on Classic Candlepins, Mike Legendre is at 131, John Starner is at 92. We'll be back with our second string right after this timeout.
Yeah. I'm Mark Ritchie, producer and director of Classic Candlepins, and this is our brand new segment called Pro Shots. In this segment, every week, we'll show you one or two different shots that you might see at your league or any other time that you go bowling. However, we're going to give you the professional's perspective on how we shoot these shots, how we might play the wood, and how we might cut a pin over here and there. Week to week, we'll have different bowlers who've made the show, some who haven't made the show. They'll be fresh faces to you. But all of the pro bowlers will get together and we'll show you different ways of shooting different shots. It's all as individual as the bowler. Some of us like to play shots one way. Some of us play the exact same shot a completely different way. So this way, you'll get to see multiple facets of the game of candlepin that we play. Today being show number one, we're going to start with the most basic of things that we have to do, hitting the head pin. It is so important on your first ball to give yourself a shot at either throwing a strike or being able to make a spare by hitting the head pin on your first ball. Any pro will tell you, anybody who's bowled, anybody who loves to bowl will tell you that hitting the head pin on the first ball is the most important thing that you can possibly do. So today's episode is just going to be very basic, very simple. It's just going to be hitting the head pin.
See John Starner in that zen-like state again. He's getting fired up, I can tell.
Yes.
He's ready to explode.
Yes.
I think that's the same mood when he comes in and shakes hands before a match starts, too.
Right.
So stoic.
Mike had a 131 in our first string.
It's actually a 39 pin lead, not 32.
Oh, my bad. That's why I'm the professional statistician.
Correct. You're both college educated.
Yes.
Nice shot to start the second string.
Mike's fifth spare.
The other thing, too, is that Mike has been off the, when he has been off the head pin, the ball seems to be working, so he gets some favorable leads.
Well, you know, the other thing, too, is if you miss the head pin with the first one and you hit it with the second one, you know, you're going to get good results. So, and he's doing that. He's doing very well.
4, 6, 8, and 10, filling his spare with 6 here to start string 2. This is a tough one.
I think I would have almost played the 6-10. Feel like if you go
with the wood,
yeah,
I agree.
Trying to drive the six pin into that piece of wood.
Score that a 9. That'll put Mike at 25 here to start. Profile of our number 5 seed from Newburyport, Mass. Four horsemen right plus the 7 and the 9. Just missed the head pin that time.
He's going to try to work for a bailout here.
Well, that's one of the things we highlighted about leaving pins standing. That's a nice out.
He just made the high-low jack.
Yeah, well, like I said, it was a nice out. Trying to give the man credit. Shot not easily made. Two, 5, and 9 was taken out of that first ball. On lane 6. And he's chopping wood now, still 5 pins standing.
Shame on your Uncle Steve for rooting for him to get 3 more. John Starner has the ability to get all 5 of those pins.
This is true, yes.
Only asking for 3.
Well, 16 after 2 for John. The lead grows to 48. This is Mike Legendre. It's the second time I've seen him go Brooklyn and bury it in the pocket and have the 5, 7, 8, and 9. Nice shot.
That's the way to play it. I think if that wood came out any further, it would have been an issue.
Right.
But it was in the perfect spot.
Angled perfectly.
You had to play it.
Yes. His second mark on lane 7 this string.
Generally, if there's no wood there, you know, somehow it always seems like you leave the 8 pin. You carry the 7 and leave the 8. That's the thing that's most frustrating.
By Mike's body language, looks like he's going to throw it in the ocean, but he fills his spare with 7 and has 1-3-6.
You call that getting away with it.
Yes. Misfires that time, but the lead after box is completed up to 48. And score that at 9, that'll put him at 51. But if you're John Starner and you have a 5-string high of 749, you're capable of throwing a big number at any time, so.
Seems like his ball's drifting a little bit left.
Four, seven, ten.
Speaking of that high five, we should note that we once faced John in a Friday night match, and he threw a 460 plus against us.
He annihilated us. One of those situations. It was fun to watch, that's for sure.
Sure, yeah.
Could not carry the 10. Anytime someone throws a big number like that, is there any mercy rule?
This isn't the Little League.
Oh,
this
well,
is the pros, Kyle.
Yes. Well, that's a 9. John is searching. Here, he is very familiar with bowling in downtown Amesbury, as he's the captain of the men's Friday night Pro League team. Light hit and has a single pin, and we'll have a clear shot at the 9.
That is our first 9-pin drop of the day.
Yes. And
does enough to take it out.
You'll do whatever you can. Spare in the 4th.
Maybe that's the thing that'll get him going.
Hey.
I mean, he's gonna cut into the lead. You know, if through box is completed anyway.
Sometimes you just need a break. Especially the splits he's had. He'll be able to cut into that lead because Mike was open in the 4th. The 6 pin will not go.
That was a great bid. Right in the pocket.
I think the wood cost him on that shot.
I think you're right. Yep. And a 10 box. Well, that 6 pin really did not want to go, even on that single. It knew it was hit, and it was reluctant to fall.
Stubborn.
Yes, that it was.
Mike open in the 5th. Is John? He's giving John an opening here. John puts a big fill, another mark.
Yeah, throwing a double if Mike can't mark here, and it's going to be tough for Mike to do it, but he's very capable as he's looking at 3, 4, 6, and 10. As we've mentioned before, the winner of this match will face our number 3 seed, Dave Chestercove, or is the man that I call Chester Copperpot.
And why is that?
Well, because he's the man that searched for One-Eye Willie.
Oh, okay. Yes.
And had a Lou Gehrig baseball card, too.
As impressive.
Yes. That's a 9 box, and Michael B. 70 after 6. Fills it with 6. He's got the 4 horsemen left. Ooh. He was on the object that time, but it'll be open in the 5th. That's an 8 box, and John will be at 49. He does have a Pro Series playoff appearance to his credit. He was also on the Candlepin for Kids show. As I mentioned before, he lives in Newburyport. And the 5 pin will stand, but it does have a piece of wood next to it.
I think he's got to be north of the red line.
Yes. And the 10 will not go. Box will put him at 59 after 6. A little more than halfway through our second string with the first round here on Classic Candlepins. Light in the pocket. The reverse check mark, as it were, 2457. More money for the
nickel fund.
Yes. Nice shot. Mike has done a fair amount of damage on lane 7.
What's good right now is he has the leaves where if you throw the ball, you know. And it's the ones that should go. He's hitting them, and that's what's good, is he's putting it where it's supposed to go, and, you know, you throw a good ball, you think, that's going to go, and it does, and it's working out for him right now. And it's still bonus pins.
That time, the ball got away from him a bit, and he fills his spare in the 7th with 3, which will put him at 83. So he'll be open in the 8th. Nice shot for a 10. That'll put him at 93.
That's not an easy 10. He just converted the 1-2-9. That's a great shot.
He continues to pin very well.
Yes. Yeah, only 2... No, excuse me, 3 pins standing so far in the first 8 of string number 2.
Yes.
One, six, seven, nine. possibilities with the wood here.
I think you got to go right of the head pin, though. I feel like if you try to go ball to the left of the head pin, you're not gonna take out the seven pin.
It's almost like that piece of wood just deadened the ball from doing more damage. But 9 will put John at 68. Three, six, and nine on that punch out. And there's still three pins standing.
He's looking at that 1-8-10 for a 10 box.
I'll put John at 77. 55 is the difference.
Mike up on lane 7 again. Buries the head pin.
But he's got the 6-7.
That is an ugly split.
He's got some wood, though.
Did you go low on it?
I think so.
Oh!
He just cuts it over.
He doesn't need to use the wood. He just cuts it over, and it's not a big deal. His fourth mark on lane 7.
I suppose you could just do that.
Yes. Well, you have the talent to do that, as does Rich. I can just talk about it. Hope to someday throw a ball pain-free anywhere.
Well, yes. I would say, you know, considering Mike's ball breaks right to left, I figured that shot was incredibly difficult for him, where Frank, being a lefty, goes towards the 10 pin where he'd be able to cut the pin over, so
right.
It'd be easier for him, where it's the 4-10 is easier for me than it is for Frank. Mike on the head pin again, a nice 7, Phil.
Triangle left, 4-7-8, no wood, and puts it down. So back-to-back marks to end string number 2. Puts him at 120 with the ball.
Mike's really putting the pressure on here now.
Yes. I mean, very methodical, workmanlike approach.
Yes.
Making it very difficult. And even when he's off the head pin, he's able to get some good action, and that 8 will put him at... A spare 8, excuse me, I'll put him at 128. And at 259 after 2.
John Starner has some work to do, for sure.
That he does.
He's got to get 2 here.
He's looking at 4 horsemen right, 1, 3, 6, and 10. And in this game, you just need to have the marks, and when you get them, fill them. And ball drifted on a little bit. And he's in the face for the 10. That'll put him at 87. But in this game, you never know. I mean, we were just talking about Mike in the knockout against Derby, and as soon as I say that, he's got the 5 pin. He's right on it.
John's 2-for-2 on singles.
He's 97 with the ball right now. Fills his spare with 4. That'll put him at 101. And we have 2 down and 1 to go. After the second string, Mike Legendre is at 259. John Starner is at 193. 66 pin difference with 1 string to go. First round matchup on Classic Candlepins. We'll be back with our third string right after this timeout.
So with today's emphasis being on hitting the head pin, most important thing that you can realize is that the grip on your bowling ball means absolutely everything. You can't just pick it up and fire it and expect to get good results every time. We on the pro ranks will hold our ball the same exact way every single time. This ensures that we get the same release, the same grip every time we roll the ball to give us the maximum chance of hitting exactly what we want to hit. So the best way I can tell you to pick up a bowling ball is to pick it up how you take it off the rack, nice and firm, all 5 fingers being in contact, evenly spaced across the ball like this, with your thumb and your pointer giving you that nice U on the side. Now, some people hold the ball wide, some people hold the ball very tight. It's all about what feels good in your hands. That's the only real thing that matters, because these shots are as individual as the bowler itself. So when I pick up the ball, I tend to have my fingers be very close together, all things considered. And then this way, I can make sure that the ball leaves my hand the same way every single time. To make sure that you hit the same spot that you want to hit, I also recommend standing in the same place on the lane every single time. Don't move too much. If you have to move, if you find you're missing by just a little bit, you can move left or to the right or up or down, but no more than 1 or 2 inches each time. Now, when you want to hit the head pin on the first ball, the most important thing is to just throw at the head pin. Not to worry about what happened last frame, not to worry about what you'll get after it. Because once you block all that stuff out, it's just you and 10 pins every frame. And that's the most important thing that I pass on to the people that I instruct. It's just you and 10 pins every single frame. So take the ball and don't worry about it. Just pick it up and throw it at the middle. Throw a nice hard ball right down the middle of the lane. If you curve or if you backspin one way or the other, try to get it out into the middle of the lane to give yourself the best possible chance of hitting the head pin. I'll illustrate. Come to a nice set position, look at your target, and throw at it. And that's the best possible thing that you can do in the game of Candlepins to give yourself the best chance of scoring. Thanks for watching this week's edition of Pro Shots. We'll see you next week. Enjoy the rest of the show.
Welcome back to Downtown Amesbury as we're about to start our third string here. We're going to have our game reset after our second string with the illustrious Frank Face, and what are some of the trends you saw after 2, Frank?
Thanks, Kyle. So just like the first string, I tracked pin standing. For John Starner, he left 9 pins standing. Mike Legendre, 3. The first ball average for John Starner, 5.9 pins to Mike's 6.5. They each had 2 splits. John had 2 marks, and Mike Legendre had 5 marks.
Which puts him at 10.
Yes, for the match total. And we can see a trend here. Pinning marks, and I think John's slightly off the head pin, but we know what he's able to do, and anything could happen during his string.
I think another trend, too, is that the consistency that Mike has had with that first ball average, 6.5 in the first string, 6.5 in the second.
Yes.
He has 10 marks so far. Generally speaking, in Candlepin, they say, if you want a 400, 15 marks is the way to do it.
Absolutely.
So, let's go for...
He's well on his way.
Yes, let's go for the third string of this first round match. John Starn will be up. He's at 193 after 2. The difference. But we we know that he's capable of exploding at any time, and as soon as I say that, he has a single pin to look at with a plank, so even though opening day or opening night is tomorrow, Easter's tomorrow, very exciting. Spare it up. Did I just make that up? It is
definitely Easter.
And no, that but was I'm definitely talking about opening night for...
Yeah, it's opening night.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah, St. Louis against the Cubs.
Yes. Rich only has 13 fantasy baseball teams.
It's not that. It's only five.
Well, you know. Here's the bonus. Didn't get the action he was looking for as he fills his spare with five on that thin hit. 2-4-5. 6-10, no wood to help. This is a tough shot, but if he can make this, that'd be a great way to start our third string. You know, he was right on the object, but Rich, as you said, shooting at the triangle is not easy.
No, and there's a certain bowler out there those are his nemesis shots. Mr. Chris Sacchetti that we've mentioned fondly on Alley Chat.
I thought you were talking about my uncle once again. 23 after 2 for John, and upsteps Mike Legendre. He's throwing the ball very well. All the way from beautiful Blackstone, Mass.
That one kind of got away from him. Not too bad considering he's got an 8-pin drop out of it.
This is true.
He's going to have to play that wood, though, see what happens.
Mike is 37, married.
Oh!
And
that is very close.
I'm not sure if that wood is legal or not.
But we're going to have Chester Copperpot take a look at it just to make sure. And Chester's removing that pin. He may need that next week. Mike has the house record for five strings in Franklin with 723.
That is impressive.
That's ridiculous.
Yes.
I mean, you throw a 723 pretty much anywhere. You're doing yeoman work, but...
Just sitting on the day at the office.
Yes.
Or in the park, you might say.
Right. At 723 is actually my high 10, believe it or not.
Oh, so, congratulations. Yes.
Thank you. And a punch out on lane 6.
And from what I understand, his home house is classified as difficult or tough to bowl at.
Yes.
So,
well,
even better.
Right, as I say.
What a bid on the very nearly. Half Worcester. Leaves the 5-pin.
Yes. And a 10 box will put Mike at 19 after 2. So a couple pins and count. John will look at 1, 3, 7, and 8.
That piece of wood might be helpful.
I don't know if it'll carry the 8, though.
If he's a little bit full on the head pin, his ball should take out the 8 pin because it's going to drift behind. Or it's just that way.
Great shot, nonetheless. His second spare of the third stanza. Anytime you use the word stanza as it relates to Candlepin bowling, you're a man of
Shakespearean authority.
Correct, yes. 5, 4 horsemen right plus the 7. Everything but the head pin. And a 10 box for John, put him at 48. Ask Mike if he defeated his twin brother on the Comcast show, because I can't remember. He's been doing this all day, burying it in the pocket.
Especially he improved in the second string.
There it is. Spare in the third. Bonus. Just missed the head pin that time. He'll fill it with seven. Gains a couple pins and count.
You know, it's amazing how many of these extra pins he's been carrying when he's been off the head pin. And it's a huge difference right now for this match.
Another spare from Mike Legendre. He has not let up at all. And Rich Limone, he's got the ball working.
It's hard to argue. It's up to 11 spares.
A light hit. The diamond plus the 7. 2, 4, 5, 7, 8. For those of you scoring at home. Yes. That is a great shot by John Starner. Finding a rhythm here in the third string. As the gallery looks on here, our fourth ladder series. And John will fill his spare with 5. That's the third spare 5 of our third string from John. Gives him a 63 half, which is more like what he's accustomed to. And he's heavy on number 1 that time. And the frustration etched on John that time is you can't do much better than hitting the object. And that'll be a 9 box.
72 after 6.
Yes. Mike Legendre has back-to-back spares. He's 46 with a ball in the third. And he's through the middle with the big 5 leave.
Takes out 2 more. He's left with the 2, 3, and the 6 pin.
And score that at 9. That'll put Mike at 60. So he'd need an 81 half to put him at 400.
Which he can do.
Yes, he can. One. 1, 3, 6, and 9.
This would be a good place to start.
A little off that time.
Still searching for our second 400 on the show.
Yes. Brandon marks 401 in the semifinal of that first ladder. One is a 10 box. You know, Mike's style kind of reminds me of Kevin Davis a bit.
I could agree with that for sure.
Short approach, quick to the line.
Kevin's a little bit more speedy, I think.
Yes.
But I would say very similar.
And Kevin throws harder, too, I think.
No, I would agree with that. Yeah, absolutely.
Both very accurate.
Yes. And John is able to break up the split. He's looking at the 6-10. And there it is. His fourth spare of this third string. He's had a couple of those Mrs. Riley duck soup marks where you get the favorable wood, and hopefully that'll get him into a groove. And all four are on lane 7. Right in the pocket and nearly a strike. He's got the 10 pin.
Nice 9 fill for John.
Yes.
Puts him at 91.
Breaks the cycle of 5 fills.
Yes. Just missed. And the 9 will put him at 100.
He's 3-for-4 on singles today. That was one he really needed if he was going to dig and claw. Especially if Mike ends up being open, these two.
Mike will be looking at a split. He's at 3, 6, 7, and 10. Care of the right side.
It's a good bid.
Trying to get action moving from right to left, and it didn't happen that time. But have another 10 box. And that's the second. He only has 2 pins that he's left standing here. The 80 after 7, the lead is 55. Up the split, he's got 6-10.
It's another one of those situations, that flat piece of wood, it's going to hit it. It's going to miss it. I was hoping he hit it, and then somehow the 10 pin doesn't go. It seems like it happens all the time. You would think that that's lined up perfectly. But
that's one of the few misses.
I will never know.
That Mike has had. I'm sorry to talk over you.
We're a team.
That we
can
are.
All talk at the same time.
Yes.
That's why people have 2 ears. They can listen to us.
Correct. Frank, anything to add?
I don't know if I have enough ears to listen to both of you guys.
Oh, wow. There's a chill in the air of downtown Amesbury.
I'm kidding.
No, I don't believe it. Here's John up for his final 2.
Speaking of listening, you could always listen to the web's only Candlepin Bowling podcast, Alley Chat.
Oof. I served that up and you knocked it out of the park.
Yes.
Bad wing and all.
Right. That is at alleychat.frankface.net.
There should be some exciting guests in the future on the show?
I'm very confident there will be.
You sound excited about
yes.
it. I'll tell you that much.
Won't mention any names, but...
All right, this, you know, you can keep it family friendly. Well, sometimes that doesn't happen on the show.
Right,
but
right. That's my concern.
Right.
It's generally my fault.
And that's quite okay.
Yes.
John, all over the head pin that time. Gets an 8-pin drop, leaves a 9-10 with a piece of wood up against both of them. I would tend to think you'd have to go right at the 9-pin.
Well, he concludes our match with a spare up in the 10th. That'll put him at 120, which has him at 313 right now. And he fills it with six, a 126. And I think 319. I think.
You are correct.
Oh, wow. How about that? The Adderall
well
really
done.
Does work, and I didn't even take it today. How about that? Mike is 89 after 8. And he's looking at 1, 2, 9, and 10. Played it about as well as you're gonna play it, but couldn't get any action to the 9 and the 10.
Yeah, I mean, it hit the sidewall. It just didn't. It came across. It didn't go deep enough. Unfortunately, makes the 10 anyway.
And again, only 3 pin standing. He does have the 2 marks. This is one of John's favorite leaves, the 5-6-10. That piece of wood will roll into the channel.
This would be a great shot to close out the match.
Yes. And an 8 will finish Mike with a 107, and he'll conclude with a 366, so Mike Legendre will be moving on to our second round matchup next week against Dave Chestercove as he defeats John Starner 366 to 319, and we'll talk with our bowlers right after this timeout. Welcome back to downtown Amesbury, our first round match of Classic Candlepins, our fourth ladder of the series. And here we are with John Starner, our fifth place finisher of this roll-off. And we could see you struggling today, but the thing is that we were talking about it after the first and of the second string there, where you had this trouble breaking up the splits there. But sometimes when you're laboring, it just makes it very difficult to come back in the match, especially the way Mike started off.
Yeah, it's been a rough couple of months. It's been like that. Just trying to adapt, trying to adjust, and I just couldn't make the right adjustments today.
I thought you were throwing a good ball, though. I think Rich said the same thing.
I mean, you looked better on the lanes today than you did in the first ladder. I mean, pins just weren't moving in your favor. I mean, I know you were trying to make adjustments out there. It's tough when he's making shots left and right, and you have nothing to look at. What adjustments did you try to make up there?
I slow down my feet, but a little bit more rotation on the ball. Just trying to get something just to get a little bit more of a splash. And it just couldn't really make the right adjustment until the third game where I started to, you know, just kind of move my feet from side to side and get the pocket more direct. But hey, my ball is flat today. Mike bowled very well today. Not taking anything away from him. He's been bowling well as of late. So yeah, good for him. I hope he does well against Chestercove.
John, thanks for coming back. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
That's John Starner, everybody.
Thank you.
And now we're going to speak with Mike Legendre here, who finished fourth in our ladder and is the victor today. You threw a great ball. We were talking about bowling in at FICO's, yeah. And you know, the paperwork may say 114, but we know that 114 means different there than it does in most houses.
Yeah, every house is totally different. You know, I've bowled here a lot, so I know how the house is and all that stuff. And, you know, doing the Friday Night Pro Series and all that stuff, you know, you do that and you get used to a house, so you know how it works and all that stuff. And, you know, John is a great bowler. He just wasn't getting the breaks. And, you know, I took advantage of my breaks, and that's the difference of the game. You know, I didn't hit the head pin a lot, but if you're over 50, 60%, that's usually you do pretty well, you know. And if, you know, if you make your spares missing the head pin, that's what you need to do. So that's what I did.
Well, I mean, you were 50% on the head pin. That's a good number to be at, you know. And when you missed, you got some really good action. So, you know, you were lucky you didn't have to make any adjustments up there. You just throw your ball. You know, and it worked out for you. You know, it was good to see. It was newcomer on the show, so you did very well, and congratulations. I don't really have a question. I just know that you bowled very well.
I thought all your comments were fantastic. So you're a credit to the show.
I am a credit. So are you.
Oh, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to end this love fest here. Our first round matchup is completed. Mike Legendre moves up one ring on the ladder to face Dave Chesterkove next week. For our entire crew and Rich Limoney, I'm Kyle Bruce. We'll see you next week on Classic Candlepins.
All right. Well, Mike Legendre moves on in our first round matchup, defeating John Starner 366 to 319. And Frank DeLuca, that was a match in which Mike was able to find his timing right out of the gate, it seemed like, pretty much.
Indeed, Kyle. And, you know, when you have a guy who's 259 after two, Mike Legendre, and you build a deficit that's just too much to handle, it's going to be tough. John did find his strive, his method. It was just a little too late. And, you know, in the third string, he threw upwards of five marks, and it just wasn't enough. He did make a run at it, but it just was too little too late.
Well, that's how the game works. That's how cannel pin bowling is. And our second round matchup next week will feature number 4 seed Mike Legendre just after this first round victory, facing our number 3 seed Dave Chesterkove. For our entire crew and Frank DeLuca, I'm Kyle Bruce. We'll see you next week.